Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Let's prepare our hearts now for the message this morning as we continue with the study in Matthew.
Good morning. I couldn't help but think of a passage that's been a real help to me several certain occasions in my life as I was thinking about the Swanson family being, I was thinking displaced, but I definitely understand the analogy of dislocated. And I love how he brought that around saying, you know, we're right where God would have us to be. And I think back to 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and there at verse 12 where Paul had come to Troas because the Lord had opened a great door of opportunity for him there. And he gets to Troas and Titus isn't there. And for whatever reason, Paul was really wanting to see Titus. So you know what Paul did? He left. Wait a minute, the Lord opened the door and he left. And this was his response to that. But thanks be to God in verse 14, who in Christ always leads us in triumphal procession. And through us spreads the fragrance of the knowledge of Him everywhere. For we are the aroma of Christ to God among those who are being saved and among those who are perishing. To one a fragrance from death to death and the other a fragrance from life to life. Who is sufficient for these things? For we are not like so many peddlers of God's word, but as men of sincerity, as commissioned by God in the sight of God, we speak Christ. Wherever God places us, we spread the aroma of Christ. And thank you for allowing the Lord to use you that way in the ministry to both the church and to the lost. I'm excited to move forward. We are going through the book of Matthew. We are still in the Lord's Prayer, but we're nearing the end of it. And we are in verse 12 today. I'd like to read to us Matthew 6, 9 through 15. Pray then like this, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we are so thankful for this beautiful day that you have given us to come together as the church, to magnify, to exalt you corporately, and to encourage one another unto love and good works, to edify one another. We thank you for the Swansons being with us. We thank you for every family who was able to be with us this morning, those who are watching. Father, I pray now as we go into your word that your spirit would deal with every heart in this place, every heart hearing this message this morning. Deal with us according to your will. And let your will be done in our life. Let us live as those who are willingly and gladly under the reign of your kingdom, under your reign as our sovereign Lord. We love you and thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen. We are at this part in the Sermon on the Mount, and we want to keep Scripture in context as we go through it, as we're studying Scripture. You never want to pull it out of context and kind of box it off to itself, set it aside, and study it apart from context, because somewhere along the way you're going to deviate from what is being said. But this prayer is right in the middle of Jesus' teaching to the crowd who were following him. He had called some of his disciples, and there's this crowd that is following him along with those whom he specifically called as his, we can call it his circle of disciples. There's this larger circle of people who have either heard of him, they've heard of some of the things that he has already done, such as cleansing in the temple the first time he did it. He's already done that by this point. Whenever he called those first disciples, he's come back to Capernaum where he started his ministry, and he's going to base his ministry here. He's already been up to Cana of Galilee, and he's already turned the water into wine there. So there's this miracle that he did there, then the driving out of the money changers in the temple. And so these things caught the attention of many people. And for whatever reason, right, wrong, or indifferent, there was a crowd following him. And so for this crowd following him, know it or not, they were following the king. John the Baptist, as we had already studied in Matthew, has been the forerunner, the herald of the king. Prepare ye the way of the Lord. And now Jesus has come. He is establishing what his kingdom looks like, what life looks like for those who are in his kingdom. And so we have the Beatitudes there. Not, those are things that we don't look to accomplish in order to get into his kingdom. Those are characteristic of those who are in his kingdom, those who belong to him. They're also, at the same time, they are goals for us to strive for. We have, we are peacemakers, but we are to strive to be peacemakers. We, every beatitude has this right now, already, but not yet sense to it, just like the whole of the kingdom of God does. And another beautiful aspect of being a member in this kingdom of God is that we get to have communion and fellowship with God himself, with our Father. And Jesus is giving instruction here on the manner in which we are to pray, the way that we are to commune with the Father. And there's actually a pattern here that Jesus is teaching us so that, we can rightly recognize who he is. These words that he has given us here are not just words to be repeated, but they're preparations of our heart as we begin to commune with the Father. Our Father, starting right there, recognizing him for who he is and us, his children. He's not my Father, he's our Father. There's a plurality in the kingdom of God, the body of Christ made up of all believers who are in heaven. This is where he is seated. This is, he is the king of heaven. He is the creator of earth. Hallowed be your name. Reverenced, treasured, valued be your name. And we go from there. It's a preparation of our heart as we begin speaking to God and bringing our petitions to him. Wiersbe notes that in this prayer, there are no singular, there are no singular pronouns in this prayer. You in this prayer is, every one of them in the Greek is plural. There's no I, there's no me, there's no my. Every one of them is plural. Sometimes in English, when we read the word you, we can't, it can be difficult to determine, is he talking to a single person or is he talking to a crowd? Unless you say y'all. And then there's the D, there's also yous, which no one down here says. And then there's a youans, but this is a whole different grammar class. This is Backwood Mountain grammar class. That's for a different sermon. But so every one of these you in here in this prayer is plural. We must always remember that we are part of the body of Christ. The kingdom of God isn't all about you. It isn't all about me. It isn't all about these singular pronouns. It's about God primarily, and then it's about one another. That's what life for the Christian is all about. It's God first and then everybody else. That's what it's about. So we have no right to ask for anything ourselves in prayer that would be injurious, that would be hurtful, that would hinder somebody else. We have no reason, no right at all to ask for anything in our lives that wouldn't be edifying to those who are around us. And if we are praying according to the will of God, the answer, God's answer to that prayer will be a blessing for those around us also. So we've mentioned often in this series that there are six petitions in this prayer. They can be separated into two groups of three. The first, which deals directly with God the Father, with His majesty, deals with His worth, His sovereign reign, deals with His will being done. And these first three petitions, if you'll notice, they're written independently of each other. Each one could be, you could put a sentence, a period right after it. There's a complete statement. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. Hallowed be your name. But these next three, in the Greek, they are linked together by the conjunction and in English. So if you look at the next three, there's an and, and an and, and an and. It's like they are all tied together. It's as if this showing the deep need of God for everything for mankind. We don't just need our daily bread. We need our daily bread and forgiveness. We need our daily bread and forgiveness, and we need you to lead us not into temptation. We need you to deliver us from evil. Our needs, there's so many of them, Lord. Jesus Himself, even when He was tempted of the devil, the devil's first temptation after Jesus' 40 days fasting was to turn stones into bread, and Jesus' response was, man shall not live by bread alone. Yes, Lord, give us this day our daily bread, but we're not done yet. We need so much more from you than food for sustenance for today. We need forgiveness of sin. And this is something that the Christian can't forget. He's telling these people, he is teaching kingdom living here. And those who are in the kingdom still ask God for forgiveness of sins. And this may seem contrary in part of our heart saying, no, I am forgiven of my sins. Then why did he say it, and why is it said in other places in the scripture? The Christian repents in becoming a Christian. Believe the gospel and repent. Repent and believe the gospel. That's the message that Jesus came preaching. But then we find that there is also a continuing of repentance as we sin. We are continually turning away from sin. We are continually having to turn away from temptation and turn our eyes unto God. So there's this, as a believer, there's this continual repentance. And we are still confessing our sins to God. It's worth repeating as we come to today's text, forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. It's worth repeating that Jesus is teaching negatively towards those who, if you look back earlier in the chapter, verses 5 through 8, don't be like the hypocrites whose prayers are made so that they can be heard. They're out in the streets loudly crying out their prayers, and they're using these vain repetitions, saying things over and over and over again, and they're just making these cold, empty, vain prayers. Don't be like the hypocrites. And everything that Jesus has been teaching so far on this Sermon on the Mount goes directly to the heart of the person. It goes directly to the heart of those who are in the kingdom of God. That's one of the Beatitudes. Blessed are the pure in heart. And from there, adultery is not just an issue of physical committing of adultery. If a man looks at a woman to lust after her, he's committed adultery with her already in his heart. Murder is not just killing of a person with your hands or with some weapon, but it's the same as being angry without cause. It's an issue of the heart. And here Jesus is still dealing with the heart in this prayer. I'd like for us to go ahead and look for just a minute at the language, kind of an academic look at the language of verse 12, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. Forgive us. Afes ermin. Pardon us. Afes means to cancel, to pardon, to let go, to cast it away, to throw it, to hurl it away. And the sense of this word is that we stop blaming somebody. We stop taking their offense into account. And that's what God does with us. He no longer is blaming us. He no longer is taking our offense into account when He has forgiven us. Forgive us our debts. And it's interesting that this word, well, I guess it's not really interesting in their day because it was used very often as debt concerning sin in their days. Ophelimata, debts, one's due, what one owes. And so forgive us our debts as we, some manuscripts say, most manuscripts would say, as we also, os kai emes, as we also, as we likewise have forgiven our debtors, as we likewise have forgiven those whose sin has incurred on them debt or injury against us. So give unto us what we have given unto them. Forget or cast aside or hurl away or no longer lay blame to us as we have done that to those who have done something against us, who are indebted to us in some way. Luke 11:4 is the parallel passage to this. Luke writes a fourth word for that phrase, having have forgiven our debtors. He writes another word, that auto, which acts as like a third person intensive predicative, if that helps you any. And the third person in the Greek refers to the person being spoken about, and an intensive predicative adds the stress of the third person pronoun when it's in the predicate position. So it reads like this: for we ourselves have forgiven. There's stress put there. Forgive us, for we ourselves, we have forgiven those, they, them, who have sinned against us. And Luke 11:4 reads it: and forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone who is indebted to us, and lead us not into temptation. So some translations read the Greek of our text in Matthew 6:12 with the same emphasis on we to the passage, which it seems very appropriate. If some of your translations read a little differently there, that's why. But it speaks to us that we not only need to be the recipient of forgiveness from the Father, but we also are to be ready and willing to forgive those who are indebted to us because of their sin. They have done something against us. How can we plead for forgiveness from God when we ourselves are not willing to let His character forgive? and his loving act of forgiveness be reflected through us in forgiving others. Forgive us our debts as we forgive or we have forgiven our debtors. Some have taken this passage literally as debts, to, as in money, as in forgiving loans. And there are some who say that at the time this was written, it was the year before Jubilee. And so he was preparing hearts for everyone to forgive everyone who owed them anything. And they will refer to Matthew 18, 23 through 25, which is the parable where Jesus Christ is talking about the unforgiving servant. You remember him? The one who the king pardoned of more debt than this guy could have paid for the rest of his life. And the king pardoned him. But then this same guy went out straightway and he went to a guy who owed him a day's wages. And the guy asked for more time. Please, I will pay you. Just give me a little bit more time. But we find the hands of this guy around the other guy's neck as he literally choked him down and then had him thrown in prison for a day's wage. And Jesus is teaching here on this forgiven servant who was unwilling to forgive his fellow servant who owed him so little. The king heard of this and called him back and he called him a wicked servant and had him thrown into prison until all was paid back, which if we know, just from what we know from studying that passage, it couldn't have been paid back. A lifetime of wages would not have paid back what the guy owed. So there is this exchanging of money, this issue of money, this loaning, I guess, of money and it not being repaid that the parable is speaking of, but Jesus isn't necessarily teaching about money here. He isn't teaching about someone owing you something here. Matthew 18, 21, we find where Peter, this is what Jesus is responding to. Peter came to him in Matthew 18, 21 and said to him, Lord, how often will my brother sin against me? And I forgive him. As many as seven times? And we know Jesus' response. You say seven times? I say no. Seven times 70. And no, 490 isn't the magic number. The issue is you keep forgiving. And then Jesus tells this parable, explaining to Peter how we are to forgive those who have sinned against us. So this word debt here is used in Greek biblical writing, but it's kind of a rare word for sin. We only see it twice in the New Testament. The other time is in Romans 4:4. Let me read you that with some context. For what does the scripture say in 4:3? Abraham believed God and it was counted to him as righteousness. Now the one who works, his wages are not counted as a gift, but as his due. As his debt, as what was indebted him. He worked and now the owner of the company owes him. He's indebted to him for his work. And to the one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted as righteousness. Just as David also speaks of the blessing of the one to whom God counts righteousness apart from works. Blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven, whose sins are covered. So the two references we have in the New Testament to this word debt being used, it has this the sentiment of sin with it, of an owing. In the sense of debts, sin has incurred the debt. It's incurred an injury against either God or an injury against somebody else. So metaphorically, we can say that debts here are moral and ethical debts. And if no one has sinned against you yet, since you've believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, either number one, you just haven't recognized it, or number two, you're going to be up for a rude awakening when it happens, because it's inevitable. People sin against us. People injure us. Jesus, whenever he's teaching this to these people, this is how you pray. And forgive us our debts as we forgive, or we have forgiven our debtors. This isn't long after Jesus was just teaching at the end of the Beatitudes. Remember, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. He's already letting them know people are going to sin against you. People are going to do things against you. They are going to intentionally work against you. Matthew 5:10, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. It's coming. People are going to sin against you. Matthew 5:39, but I say to you, do not resist the one who is evil, but if anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. That's sin. But I say to you in 5:44, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. For he makes the sun rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the just and the unjust. Sin is going to happen. People are going to sin against you. And some of that sin is going to be expressly because you claim to be a child of God, because you claim to belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. And now Jesus is teaching in this prayer. You pray to God, forgive us our sins as we have forgiven those who have sinned against us. Forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. He is definitely dealing with forgiveness of sins committed against us here. The petition is such a weighty part of this prayer. That petition, forgive us our sins, or forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, is so weighty in this prayer that Jesus revisits it two verses later. He speaks more deeply about it two verses later. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Can you see where he's dealing with the heart in this prayer? It's not just words to be vainly repeated. It's a condition of our heart as we approach God. And in this prayer, it is, forgive us our sins, forgive us our debts, as we have forgiven our debtors. I've already dealt with my heart, God, on those who have sinned against me. Now I ask you to forgive me for my sin against you. Some have read this and made it like a prerequisite to salvation. You cannot be forgiven of your sins until you have forgiven all who have sinned against you. Therefore, you cannot be saved without forgiving everybody of everything they have done against you. And this sentiment about this verse does not line up with the rest of it. Doesn't fit into biblical theology. It doesn't fit into the context of what the scripture teaches us about the forgiveness that we receive positionally as we are born again, as we are saved, as we are Christians. The forgiveness of our sin, which puts us positionally, and I'm going to use that word very emphatic there, positionally, before we stand before God positionally as clean, as righteous, as saints of God. How is that? Because of Jesus Christ. There's but one way to be saved, and that is by grace through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. By believing that His life, His death, His resurrection are sufficient to pay for your redemption. Jesus Christ and He alone is our propitiation. God has wrath stored up against us because of the sins that we have committed. He is a just God. That wrath must be poured out. And here is how it is poured out for those who believe. He poured it out on His Son, Jesus Christ. And at Calvary, Christ absorbed all of the wrath of God for all of the sin for all who would believe. And there is no wrath remaining for those who are in Christ. Christ, when He said it's finished, it's done. It is finished. There is no more wrath remaining against them because of their sin, because of our sins. So in believing in the Lord Jesus Christ, all of the sin that was affiliated with any part of our lives in the past, right now, sins to come, they've all been carried. They've all been borne by Jesus Christ on the cross. There was an exchange that took place there. 2 Corinthians 5:21, He who knew no sin became sin for us that we might become the righteousness of God in Him. He took upon Himself our sin and He placed upon us His righteousness, this great exchange that happened. So He gave us His righteousness. And that's the righteousness with which we are clothed when we stand before the judge of all the earth, when we stand before God. So positionally, we are forgiven. We stand before God clothed not in our own sinlessness, because we had none, but in the righteousness of Jesus Christ, the sinlessness of Jesus Christ Himself. We are forgiven because He who never sinned died in our place and bore the wrath of God, which was against us for all of our sin. However, even as children of God, when we sin, there are consequences. Sin is still a serious matter to the Christian. If you have the idea that now that you are saved, now that you're a Christian, you can go and commit all the sin that you want and there's never a consequence for it and you can just let your flesh go and eat till its desire is fulfilled. First of all, its desire is never fulfilled. And second of all, we need to back up and talk about your faith. When we sin as Christians, there are still consequences, though those aren't eternal separation from God and suffering in the manifestation of the wrath of God, which is hell in the lake of fire. It's not that type of consequence. But our sin still brings a separation between us and God. We see it often with Israel, where because of their sin, God shut up His blessing that He would have given them. But because of their sin and they wouldn't turn away from it, He withheld it. There were times when God was not presently close to them, but it is as if He stood back and let sin's results take their way on Him, on the children of Israel. God even designed some of those results. We know for sure. Read the book of Habakkuk. He's going to send the Chaldeans down to take the children of Israel into captivity. Because of their sin, He's designed the judgment for them. He's designed the result of their sin, the consequence of their sin. Harboring unforgiveness inevitably leads to the sin of bitterness. It's inevitable. Being unforgiving is out of character with Christ. And He is our head and we are His body. And when we are unforgiving, it is as the body rebelling against the head. And many times that causes paralysis, right? When the body and the head aren't communicating, aren't lined up. The sin of unforgiveness will separate us from the closeness and communion of fellowship with God, our Father. And we can't expect Him to forgive our sin that we are hiding, our sin that we are guarding and protecting, our sin that we are harboring when we refuse to let it go. When we love it too much to let it go, to walk away, to repent of it, to turn away from it. This forgiveness of which I speak, I talked about positional forgiveness. This could be called like paternal forgiveness, parental forgiveness. God is our Father. It's not that God is not positionally forgiven us, but as a Father, our sin separates us from the intimacy of fellowship with Him. And for the Christian, this is a very serious issue. It endangers our fellowship with the Father. Jesus said it again in Mark 11, 24, 25. Therefore I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you have received it and it will be yours. And whenever you stand praying, forgive. If you have anything against anyone, forgive. So that your Father also, who is in heaven, may forgive you your trespasses, your sins. James said it, James 2:13. For judgment is without mercy to one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. Whenever we are unforgiving, it exposes our view of our sin. It exposes our view of that person's sin who sinned against us. Your sin against me is too much for me to forgive. It's basically saying when we expect God to forgive us, God, their sin against me is greater than my sin against you. It's easier for you to forgive me than it is for me to forgive them. And that is a skewed view of our sin. That is not recognizing our sin for what our sin is. Regardless of how little we think it is a high crime against the holy God. And when others sin against us, who are we compared to God? We're sinful ourselves. C.F.D. Mole said, once our eyes have been opened to see the enormity of our offense against God, the injuries which others have done to us appear by comparison extremely trifling. Your sin against me is nothing like my sin against God. If, on the other hand, we have an exaggerated view of the offenses of others, it proves that we have minimized our own. Another biblical perspective, and I'm closing with this. Another biblical perspective that I have to preach to my own heart often is that of the attitude of Christ in doing the will of God, especially as seen in His arrest, His trial, and His crucifixion. Jesus knew from the beginning who would betray Him. He wasn't ignorant whenever He chose Judas Iscariot. Yet, Jesus spent three and a half years with Judas and the other 11 sitting around the fire, talking with them, providing for them, caring for them, teaching them. And Jesus treated Judas no different than any of the others. No differently. We see that in Matthew 26, 22, when Jesus is at the Last Supper with the disciples. And I talked about this two and a half years ago when I came here before pastoring. Jesus sitting at the Last Supper with those disciples, and Jesus informs them in verse 22 that one of you shall betray me. And all these disciples, in verse 22, you know what it says their response was? Here's what their response wasn't. Their response wasn't, it's Judas. I know it is. I've seen the way Jesus looks at him. I've seen the way Jesus rolled his eyes. I've seen the way Jesus tensed up in conversation with him. I've seen the way that Jesus spent less time with him than he did the others. And I've kind of put it together that it's Judas. That is not the conversation that was had next. When Jesus said, one of you shall betray me. Peter, Lord, is it I? James, Lord, is it I? Matthew, is it I? John, is it I? They all asked, Lord, is it I? They couldn't tell because Jesus didn't treat Judas any different than he treated them. And we can see some of Christ's perspective. I'm not saying at all that he would struggle with unforgiveness in this. I'm not saying that at all. But we see in the Garden of Gethsemane, as Jesus is praying, and he's under such anguish that his sweat is becoming as great drops of blood, and he's praying, Father, if it be your will, let this cup pass from me, but nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. He's praying, not as I would have it, but God, Father, as you would have it. And God answered his prayer immediately afterward with Judas coming around the corner with a band of soldiers with sticks and staves to come and take Jesus and arrest him. That was God's answer to his prayer. Here's my will. It's the same attitude toward those who were crucifying him. Those who had beat him, those who had nailed him to the cross, those who had mocked him and wagged their heads and spat on him and beat him. The one who made the crown of thorns and placed it on his head. The one who smote him with the reed afterwards. And Jesus' response to all of that is, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Because we find in Isaiah chapter 53, what is it, verses 10 and 11, for it pleased the Father to bruise him. He crushed him. Because this was God's will. Completing God's plan. And Jesus, from his heart, can pray, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. At the end of, I mentioned Matthew chapter 18, the parable there of the unforgiving servant. At the end of that, here's what Jesus said. And in anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay all his debt. So, also my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. How do we forgive from our heart? Well, let's start with some theology. Do we believe that God is sovereign? Do we believe that God sovereignly works all things together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose? Do we believe that? Do we believe that that all really means all, and even the bad, stinky things God intends and He works for good and He purposes it for good in our lives? Do we believe that? Jesus did. And He truly forgave from His heart because He knew what He was going through at that time. There was a bigger hand involved than the hand that held the reed. There was a bigger hand involved than the one that made the thorn, the crown of thorns. The hand of God Himself was involved. God, what are you doing? This is not Jesus' prayer. This is my prayer. God, what are you doing in my life through this circumstance? Don't let me look at that person and get my focus on that person and let the circumstance become a focal point to me. Let my focus be you and what you are doing in my life. You've brought me here. You knew this was coming. You've allowed it to come to me. You've allowed this sin to be committed against me. God, guard my heart. Keep the door of my lips that I may glorify you in this, and I take this as from you. Father, forgive them. They don't even know they're an instrument in your hand of you conforming me into the image of Jesus Christ. Look at how He was scourged for my sin. Look at how He was abused and beaten and crucified for my sin. God, this sin against me is nothing like my sin against you. And in that, you can find actually in your heart, you're forgiving them. And you know it's true because the next time you see them, you're in the grocery store, you're not jumping over to the next aisle trying to avoid them. You're okay. Because though you may not verbalize it, something in your heart could even say something like, thank you for being an instrument of God in my life to conform me more into the image of Jesus Christ. Jesus had to be nailed to the cross. It took people to do that. You want to surrender all of your life to God, there's only so far you can go in that before God has to involve other people. Does God make people sin? No, He doesn't tempt any man to sin. But God uses their sin sinlessly, even in our own lives. God, I want to be more like Jesus. Have you ever said that? Have you ever sung that? There's all kinds of songs with to be like Jesus, to be like Jesus. That's all I ask, to be like Him. Lord, let me be willing to lay down my life. And Lord, I'll even drive the nails in my feet and I'll drive the nail in that hand, but now I'm stuck. You know what God's going to do? He's going to use somebody else to drive that other nail. You can't do it. Thank you for being an instrument of God in my life. So Jesus, in this prayer, He's teaching us when we come, this has already been settled in our hearts as we're praying for forgiveness of our sins. Anything, God, that would separate me from fellowship with You, anything that would hinder our communion, that would limit any way of You working in my life, Father, please forgive me of that, because I have forgiven those who have done those things against me. Be glorified in my life. And all of this prayer points back to point number one. Hallowed be Your name. You be glorified, God. Let Your kingdom come for Your glory. Let Your will be done for Your glory. forgive me of my sins for your glory, as I have forgiven those who have sinned against me for your glory. Father, deal with our hearts. You know the work that needs to be done in my life and in each life that is here, whether it be revealing or opening the door, that hidden area in our heart that we have been hiding sin away. We've been protecting sin. We've been harboring sin inside. Lord, I pray today that we would just snatch those doors open and just confess them to you, repent of them, Lord. Or maybe it's a work in our heart that you're doing where you are now driving us to forgive, to go to that person who has done wrong against us and glorify your name by making it right, by confessing if it takes confession, by forgiving, and not just a verbal, I forgive you, that some vain repetition that we would make, some empty words, but God, that it would be from the heart, because, Lord, through this, you're teaching me. Through this, you're teaching us. Be glorified in our lives this morning. And do your work. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor. As we close the service this morning, I would remind you, if you need the words, we're going to be singing hymn number 91, but there's only one word, hallelujah, hallelujah. Let's stand this morning. Before we sing the song, let's take a couple of moments to just ask the Lord to forgive our hearts and forgive our attitudes, and to ask that our attitude be the attitude that Christ Himself had. Let's take a few moments to reflect. Dismissed. I'm going to ask that we give Andy and Natalie the opportunity to head back, and you can greet them on your way out and just tell them how good it was to have them in the service this morning. Thank you. We are dismissed.
For the work of my hands, for this is the day you've given your servant. I will rejoice and be glad for the strength I have to live and breathe. will glorify your great name. Before you I kneel and ask for your goodness to cover the work of my hands, for patience and peace to shape all my labor, your grace for thorns in my path. Flow within me like a living stream, when away the stones of pride and grief, till your ways are dwelling deep in me, and the harvest of life is grown.